a seminary friend just yesterday, actually. Yesterday morning, I wasn't supposed to be here. I thought I was. And when I got here, my secretary said, "No, you're not supposed to be here. We got someone else here." And so I ran into my friend, and he was here to go to confession. So I was like, "Well, if you want, I'll give you the express lane." And so I want to tell you a story from that. It's a beautiful story about the Blessed Mother and our time at the seminary, but I'm going to get to that at the end. So pay attention. We're going to get to that beautiful story about Mary, kind of a miracle of sorts in a way. But I want to set the stage a little by talking about the gospel. In the gospel, the disciples decide to go fishing, and so they go fishing all night. And so they're out at night, and they catch nothing. Well, you might think, well, that's just whatever. But in the Gospel of John, he plays on the word night and darkness, on the word day and light and dawn. And these things all mean something in the Gospel of John. And so today in the Gospel, they're out all night, which that darkness, you know, that the world lies in, Christ, the light of the world, not being in us. And so what really Jesus is showing us and what John is showing us is like at the Lord's Supper where he says, "Without me, you can do nothing." And that's the whole idea. They're out in the night. They're not in the light of Christ. And so they are not able to do any good thing. In the first chapter of John, it says, "In the beginning." Starts out, "In the beginning." Well, what happens in the beginning in Genesis? In Genesis, in the beginning, the first thing God creates is light. He created light, and so he is the light of the world. And so it says, "In the beginning," in the Gospel of John, was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. And in him was life. And the life was what? The light of men. The life of Christ is our light. And we didn't receive that light, the Gospel of John says, but it says, but we weren't able to put it out. And so you skip to chapter 3, and Nicodemus, one of the Pharisees, who kind of secretly maybe believes in Jesus, he comes to Jesus when? At night, when it's dark out. And John's telling us that Nicodemus was in the dark until he encountered Christ, who is the light of the world. One of the biggest chapters in John is chapter 9, where Jesus heals the man who's born blind. No one's ever done that. And they spend a lot of time in that chapter showing how the Pharisees, who could see with their eyes, but were blinded, were in the dark with their minds and with their hearts. Yeah, as opposed to the blind man who couldn't see with his eyes. He lived in the darkness, but he was able to have insight. He was able to see with his mind and with his heart. He was able to perceive the light of the world. And it's in that chapter of John where Jesus says, "I am the light of the world." And so a lot of what John is trying to tell us in the reading today is what we hear at Eucharist: without me, you can do nothing. Without the light of the world, we live in darkness. And so he calls us to stay close to our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the light of the world, and let Christ live through us, because without him we can do nothing. With him in us, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And so a lot of my penance today with Mary being out here with us was just say some Hail Marys and ask the Blessed Mother to keep us close to her Son, the light of the world, so we don't have to live in darkness or walk in darkness or do the deeds of darkness. We can let God through us do the deeds of daytime, the deeds of light. And so I'll tell you this beautiful story. Brian Hurley was the friend in seminary. I think it was my first year at Sacred Heart, and I had made some friends there, and we were doing a 33-day devotion to the Blessed Mother, the St. Louis de Montfort one. And so we backed up 33 days from Immaculate Conception. We thought, let's end on Immaculate Conception. So we counted 33 days back, and we started on that day. And it was kind of nice. We just got together for a few minutes every day and prayed the prayers and did the devotion. But on the 33rd day, where we were going to consecrate ourselves to the Blessed Mother, we went to the Marian Chapel. At Sacred Heart, there's a main chapel, and on this side's the Mary Chapel, and on this side's the Eucharistic Chapel. And so we were over here. We had dressed the altar in blue. It was beautiful. We had filled it with roses and that sort of thing. And it was just a beautiful morning, real bright and early. The sun was just coming up, but it was really, really cloudy. It was dark, and it was kind of depressing in a way. We were all geeked and all excited about this devotion we were going to do, and yet it was dark, and there we are sitting in the chapel, and we're like, well, okay. Now, in the Marian Chapel, right up towards the front, there's a window, and it's a window of Mary, and she's, you know, about like this, but it's a stained glass window. And so we're sitting there, and Brian's here, and I'm here, and the other guys are here with us, too. And it's all dark, and we're praying. And all of a sudden, right as we're praying, this darkness, this gloomy darkness, this bright light hit Brian and I. And it almost knocked us off our pew. We're like, whoa! And we both exactly at the same time went, wow! And we looked at each other, and then we busted out laughing. And I don't know what it was. It was just this astonishing bright light just comes barreling through the window. And so we're like, wow, look at each other. We're like laughing, cracking up, laughing. And we looked, where in the world is that light coming from? And we looked, and in the stained glass window, it was the face of Mary. The sun on this cloudy, gloomy day hit the face of Mary and just knocked Brian and I off our chairs. And we were cracking up, laughing, and they're still praying. These other guys had no clue what was going on. And so we felt blessed, like we were graced. And so we were laughing and lost and all that kind of stuff. And then we felt a presence behind us. And we're like, who's watching us? And so we turned around, and there's Archbishop Vigneron, probably just Bishop Vigneron at the time, the rector of the seminary. He's now the Archbishop of Detroit. He's just sitting back there with his big goofy grin on his face, like an approving father, so to speak. And light, the light of Christ. In our lives, which can get gloomy or dark, in this world, which is always a struggle of some kind, we are called to live in the light of Christ and to let Christ live through us. We're called to the Blessed Mother, to have her pray for us, pray with us, to intercede and keep us close to Christ, who is the light. And so today, one more thought. Love entered in. In John, Jesus is love. God is love. Remember that? Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever doesn't love doesn't know God, because God is love in John. And so who is it when they're fishing? Jesus said, cast your net out, you'll catch some fish. So they do. Who recognizes Jesus? The one that Jesus loved. Yeah, it was there that love entered in. The one that Jesus loved was able to recognize Jesus. Let's consecrate our hearts, and let's be the one that Jesus loved. It's an unnamed disciple in the Gospel of John. They never name who it is. Some say it was John himself. Some say it was Mary Magdalene. Some say it was unnamed so that you would put yourself in that role. So you would say, oh, I'm supposed to be that one, the beloved disciple. Today, put yourself in that role. And be the beloved disciple who, because of love, can see Jesus all through our world where other people can't. Others are not able to see. They don't have that light of love, that light of Christ, that light that shines through the face of our Blessed Mother. That's our light. That's our faith. And what a wonderful faith we have.